Good morning, everyone. Let's try this again. Good morning, everyone. May peace be with you all. What a beautiful day we have today. Fall slowly coming. Who's excited for fall? Who wants it to still be summer? Okay, so some want summer and fall. Kind of put together, make it really beautiful. Thank God for this beautiful summer fall day weather. So good morning. Announcements. So next week, Sunday, September 15th, will be Bobby McCoy as our guest speaker. So make sure you're coming and listen to what they have to say. Bring your friends and listen to the guest speaker. After church today, if you're hungry, please join us in the fellowship hall for some pancakes before you continue on with your day. That way you can have your afternoon full. And they'll be in the cafeteria, and it's going to be in the fellowship hall, and it's for the kickoff. The movie will be September 28th, where it's Jesus in ASL. Bring your friends and bring your family. It will have captions for people who require captions. So encourage people, even if they don't know American Sign Language, to come watch the movie. It's free and there will be food provided. You will need to register. There's still 2 weeks left to register. So if you haven't registered yet, please go ahead and register before September 21st. If you're interested in becoming part of the council, we do need 2 more people for volunteers, so please contact me if you would like to sign up. It's fun to be on the planning committee, plan for food, events, things like that. So we're going to try and plan a small, fun Christmas gathering. This week on Wednesday will be our first Bible study. We will have dinner at 5:30 that first week, and then at 6:30, move to this room for Bible study. And we'll talk more about how to use mapping from the Bible to help you understand it better. It's interesting and it's fun, and it'll go on for 3 weeks. So come learn more about mapping. It'll be a lot of fun, and you will learn a lot. We are going to try to do this more often, and this will help you in the long run. Someone wanted to make an announcement regarding this. It's Mike Moore. He has an invention called Jacari Easy Wake. So you can go ahead and check this out. Oh. It's like a whisk for like eggs to pop can or open jars and stuff. It's like a type of whisk or something that you can use, I guess, for eggs. Whipping cream, I don't know, whatever you need to whisk up. Okay, and you can buy that through Amazon. It is a deaf-owned, deaf company, so if you would like to go through him directly and help this person out, he's an inventor, correct? Anyway, so if you would like more information on this, I have this for you. Are there any other announcements? Jeff has an announcement. No, I don't know. All right, moving on. It is time to praise, so Lynn will come up and lead our praise time. Good morning. Let the music begin. Please rise if you can. What a beautiful song. Thank you so much, Lynn. Now it is time for the prayer requests. So if you want time to think, write your prayer down and put it in the box, feel free.
Yeah.
So someone did inform me that we would like to offer a prayer for the Atlanta, Georgia school shooting. So please keep that in your mind. We are praying for the victims of that school shooting. Now it is time for the love offering, whatever you feel you in your heart that you can give. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. Thank you for everything that you have done up through now. We thank you for all that you still have left for us to do. Thank you for Jesus and his sacrifice on the cross to forgive us for our sins so that we might be rejoined with you. Reach out and touch the souls and help all be connected with you in heaven. Please guide the words that Jeff will preach today and give him the words to say. Send your Holy Spirit down so that we might hear what you have to tell us. Please pray for the victims of the Atlanta, Georgia school shooting. Be with their families and friends for what they are going through in this hard time of grief and pain. Touch each one of them. Help them understand why this has happened. Help us to understand that we need what we need to do to reduce the school shootings for in the future. These horrible things happen, the question comes up, and we ask ourselves why. So please come and comfort us and give us understanding. Bless those who are not here today. Reach out and touch them, care for them, and keep them safe. Bless them, watch over them, and protect them. Thank you for everything you have done. Thank you and bless us this week. Bless our food for the pancake kickoff today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Once again, it is time for praise, so Lynn will come up and lead us in song. One moment, waiting on technology.
Thank you.
Peace be with you all. Who likes that one versus good morning? Do you guys like good morning or peace be with you? All right, okay. Before we start today, before I begin my preaching, I would like to show you something. So I went with my wife to a movie last week and I decided to go. The movie The Forge. So as I was watching the movie, I realized, well, it's a really good movie, but there's a very key word. I strongly suggest you go if you have not seen it. It is a very Christian movie. So again, and if you need to know the name of the movie, please see me. It is called The Forge, but if you need a reminder after, please see me. Anyways, so have you been thinking about the last two sermons on joy and beauty, the beauty of heaven? How do you feel thinking about the last few weeks before we begin to add another one? I do apologize for last week. I feel really bad that there was no interpreter. It doesn't really benefit, not only benefit you, but it does benefit hearing people to have the interpreter. So I do apologize for there not being an interpreter last week. Now today, we are going to get to learn a little bit more about the benefits. Not like benefiting of yourself, like this sign benefit, but the benefits of heaven. This is part of a series, and we are on the third part of this series, the benefits of heaven. Now, can any of you guess what the benefits of heaven would be? Can anyone guess before we begin? More service to him? Okay. Better bodies, better health? Okay. Joy? Yes. Peace? Yes. Eternal life? Yes. Joy? Yes. When I was planning this sermon, The Benefits of Heaven, I made a list. And apparently there are 10 benefits of heaven as shown in the Bible. That's a lot. But in order for us to understand what these benefits are, we have to see this. It's something for us to look forward to. Are you guys excited? We learned joy, beauty, benefits. We have so much to look forward and be motivated for. I believe eight of the 10 benefits, are from the same book in the Bible, the book of Ephesians. The book of Ephesians shows them very poignantly. The book of Ephesians explains that all that follow Jesus are members of a holy body. That's all those a part of his church. Are you ready to learn what the benefits of heaven are today? All right, and the first benefit of heaven. The first benefit, resurrection from sin and death. We are free of it. This is shown in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. In the past, you were spiritually dead because of your sins and the things you did against God. Yes, in the past, your lives were full of those sins. You lived the way the world lives, following the ruler of evil, powers that above the earth. That same spirit is now working in those who refuse to obey God. Paul reminded us that here on earth is temporary. And we urge you to keep going, to look what's even in this world. And that you should be the ultimate citizen here. But really, we want to be citizens of heaven. With that, we see, don't blow it off. We pray to transform ourselves and to accept Jesus and follow what his will for us is and what he does. Live by example with humility and humbleness. Sin less. Get rid of those bad habits. And we receive God through Jesus. Jesus came to stand with us as one of us. And he died on the cross in order to alleviate the world from the sins, to take our sins from us. And that was the first benefit. Understand, everyone in heaven is bad, but by the grace of God and Jesus, we are saved. It is through his grace, through the grace of Jesus, for what he had done for us by his death and sacrifice on the cross. In a way that makes sense, we were spiritually dead before we were born again. Do you guys know what born again means? That's your old life, you've given it up and gathering to yourself a new life. So it makes sense that the old you dies and you are resurrected. And in heaven you get a new life. Do you remember joy? When I was talking about joy and happiness? Jesus said, it's paradise. He used the word paradise. And I'll say it again. Paradise will be shocked. We will have never seen such beauty. With all of the beautiful different colors and stone. But still, our good deeds here on earth will never be good enough to simply satisfy God. It is only through Jesus Christ that we are even able to see God. We are not good enough. It is only through His grace and love. That's a free gift, right? Jesus has already paid the price for our sins. And He paid for our way. That is what Jesus did. For He is the truth, the way, and the life. Before Him, the gates of heaven were closed. So that's the first benefit of heaven, to resurrect us from the sin and death, so that we can be born again. And He makes us truly and eternally alive. And this will be this through the spirit of rebirth. So now let's move on to the second benefit. So the second benefit that we receive is God's mercy and love. Again, we find evidence of this in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 5. But God is rich in mercy, and He loved us very much. We were spiritually dead because all that we have done against Him. But He gave us new life together with Christ. You have been saved by God's grace. Do you see those two lines that are very important? Mercy, love. This is what He did. Even though we did things that were bad or awful, He still loves us and offers us mercy. And this is the second benefit of being in heaven. Not to show our worth by what we do, so after what I said, can you keep going on the way you were going? No. You must change your ways and practice. Discipline yourself to follow more the ways of God. Have that conversation, the dialogue with the Lord. Help others. Serve others. And in doing so, you will lessen the sins you create, which will be pleasing to the Lord. We were born in sin. We have sin already. But because we have that desire to sin, the whole world is there tempting us. Temptation, desire, that feeling of I need. And if we continue down this road of sin, and we continue to sin again and again, this is an offense to God. Maybe we think, oh, well, we're good people. I'm a good person. We're good to people, but yet we still sin. Each of us sins equally. Maybe we'll say, oh, well, this is a good person. This person's bad. But at the same time, God sees us the same. As he looks down on us, he sees what we do as being the same. For example, murder versus theft. Those two acts are equal in the eyes of the Lord. Let's say you go to the store and you steal something. It's worth $20. You just stick it into your pocket. It is the same, even though we view murder as being awful. To take the life of a human being is absolutely horrible, but in the eyes of the Lord, the two sins are the same. So here it says God has such a great love for us. He's rich in mercy. He's not poor or lacking in love. He does not dole out love in little bits or to special people, but he loves us all. Wow. So now the question becomes, how did God make us alive with Christ? He gave us the free gift of salvation. Through who? Through Jesus Christ. He had found a way for him to forgive the sons and daughters on earth that follow him. This is you. This was his plan, and his plan has already been perfect. Wow. But now we are given the choice to make on whether or not we wish to accept it or to give it. You do have the choice to choose Jesus, and if you're here, you have. With that, we notice the next benefit. We understand that it is not by good works alone, although we do need to do good works. It is not by having a good attitude and making your own way. What is it you must do? For there is a way, and it is through Jesus Christ, accepting Jesus. Again, Jesus said, no one can see the Father except through me. He said, accept that word, accept. You know how a lot of people like to kind of go around, they don't want to hear the direct answer, they want to try and figure out their own way. But Jesus was very clear. You only go through him. There's no way around it. There's no alternative path. It is only through him. Yes, we are sinners. We deserve hell. We deserve to go to hell for all of the things that we have done, all of the sins that we have done. But through God's great love for us, and through his mercy, we are saved. And that is the second benefit. The third benefit of heaven The third benefit of heaven is extremely important: to have a meaningful life. Again, we're looking at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. God has made us what we are. In Christ Jesus, God made us new people so that we would spend our lives doing the good things He has already planned for us to do. I want you to notice two things. He already planned for us since the day we were born. He's already planned the good deeds for you to do. Some of you still, you come to church, you worship, and you praise Him. And we say, God, the second thing I want you to notice is, God has made us what we are. He has made each and every one of us. God created each of us for an important purpose. Don't change this. You are born in the image of God. Now, the image of God, we all look very different, but I encourage you to do something and to follow His path and what He teaches us about life. Now imagine, even me, I don't understand how life is truly created. You look at your skin and your body and your bones and your mind, your hair, glasses, well, not my glasses, but my eyes. I use glasses so I can see. Some can hear music. To create this human body, I can't even imagine all the beautiful things that each one of us were given a life for. To make a meaningful life, a life worth living, and that is in the service and doing the important works for Him. He has already prepared in advance. Pay attention to that word. He has already prepared in advance. He knows what's going to happen. So in 2025, the new year, none of us know, as of right now, who's going to win the election. The Lord does. By serving the Lord and serving each other, we serve Him. Spread the word and create a meaningful life. When you die, and you die in sin, you don't have life. But when you accept Christ into your heart, and you are transformed through faith, we will be born again. And this is the third benefit the Lord gives you: a life worth living for. That's a beautiful thing, to have a life that is so beautiful. We don't understand why people die, but we must accept that each one of us does have that purpose and meaning, which leads us to the next benefit. The fourth benefit, a purpose for living. Notice the word purpose. Again, we look to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6 through 7. Yes, it is because we are part of Jesus Christ that God raised us from death and seated us together with Him in the heavenly places. God did this so that His kindness to us who belong to Jesus would clearly show for all time to come the amazing richness of His grace. We are seated with Him, not separate. No, we are seated together. So suppose if the president were here, would he allow us to sit at his table and eat with him? No. But in this case, Jesus says, yes, we shall be seated together. A purpose for living. We have this to look forward to and to be motivated for. When we are there, we shall see him, sit together, and rejoice. This is what will happen. Paul said that God has given us a purpose for living. And God will raise us up with Christ. And we shall be seated with him in heavenly places. He has shown us that grace and mercy, as we see in this verse, that we must have a purpose for living. Not just to kind of just, we are living, vibrating, visible, breathing creatures. We all breathe, we all are visible. We all have, we show our character and we get the mercy and grace of God through Jesus Christ. So we must also show that mercy and grace. See, for me, I see you. And I might say, well, why are you doing that? But the Lord says, why are you not serving? Now suppose, you know, we get upset at each other and we break up. And maybe someone would reject the Lord and say, well, I see this, but I wish to back away from it. I do not want that relationship. I don't want to, quote, deal with that person. But maybe you see this person and you desire to help them, not to replace them, but to help them. You notice these and you make comments and say, this person is good. But they're not reflecting God. It must be clear that we reflect God. For we are ambassadors. We must show for him what it is to serve him. For we are the Lord's ambassadors. For example, if we go to another country, we are still representing God, for we are citizens, not only like not the same as citizenship here. The citizenship here that we have on earth or to our country, the United States, is only a temporary citizenship, for we are citizens of heaven, and everything we do here on earth must be as a representative of a citizen of heaven. And we must walk, or we are walking billboards. We are the walking advertisements of Jesus' love. We are advertising for him and doing his work, bringing his word out there as advertising it. It's such an amazing grace. My favorite song is Amazing Grace. Have some of you heard it? Maybe you like the song Amazing Grace. This is how he is. It is who he is. He, the Lord, is amazing grace. And we must give him our love. We are the representation of the citizens of heaven. That is our purpose for living. Now, how do you get paid? You get rewarded later in heaven. Now, I honestly do not know what that reward is, but I do know that it is better than any benefit or money that you could receive here on earth, and that is true. The fifth benefit is fulfilling work to do. And once again, we find this in the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verse 8 through 9. I mean that you have been saved by grace because you believed. I want you to look at that word really quick, believed. You did not save yourself. It is a gift from God. You are not saved by the things that you have done. So there is nothing to boast about. Just say, I accept Jesus in my heart. That's it. That's all it needs to be. Wow. This is a life gift. So do you guys remember number 3? This kind of relates to number 5. God created us to do his work, not to be for ourselves. Not that he's looking down, making sure that we're doing good things, but he is being very selective in how he created us. Doing good deeds benefits others, and we feel a sense of fulfillment. This is how we must live our life in conjunction with what God has given all of us in that spiritual gift. And we serve, we do our works in service of the Lord. So some of us might have the work, and we might make comments and we make efforts. But we must have the faith and to pray and say, I will pray for you. And this is the gift God has given us. He has selected the leaders for the church and organizations. But God can use all the gifts that he has given you through his teachings. And these gifts then are taught. Even, for example, wisdom, advice. God chooses because he has this planned a long time ago. And when we follow his plan, we will feel that fulfillment. Maybe some of you are feeling a little lost, that you don't have these gifts. Have faith, you do. Don't be negative. Be positive. Trust in the Lord. Pray on it. Have faith. And then you will find how it to be fulfilled. So I have a question. Something I've been thinking about. Jesus What if you do not serve or you do not use your gifts in service? If you are not witness to or showing your faith to the world, only they who do will be given the gift. In this case, people who use their gifts versus those who do not have the faith, do not use their gifts, or in all honesty, are simply lazy. You have to push past that. You need to be encouraging. Don't pick on. Don't say, well, you need to do this, you need to do that. Those are not the words the Lord chooses us for us. We must be positive and encouraging. Say, you need to have fulfillment and worth in your life for the Lord. If you are not using your spiritual gifts and faith, then you are not living or doing the fulfilling work you have planned for you. For the work that you do is for the Lord. And to be a witness for the Lord. Which brings us to number 6. Well, now we finally are going to be looking at a different book. So this verse comes from Philippians chapter 3, verse 20. The benefit 6, heavenly citizenship. But the government that rules us is in heaven. We are waiting for our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, to come from there. So this speaks similar to what we have on earth. Earth is temporary, and we are waiting for our Lord to come from heaven. And we are citizens of heaven. And we must, when we are in heaven, we will adopt the culture and the values, the practices in heaven. All of those things that we are used to, that have attached themselves to us here, sin and temptation, will not join us in heaven, and instead we shall arrive there in joy. Also, there's no members of a political group in heaven. the ethics. There will be no ethnicities, no tribes, no nations, no death. No wealth. No investments. And we shall be happy together. And Jesus shows us this. We will continue in heaven to talk about our King, Jesus Christ. When we enter heaven's gates, we will thank him and proclaim our great King, Jesus. And we here must help others. Does that make sense? All right, so let's... Now we're going to go back to Ephesians. So Jesus was no longer a stranger. We must follow the citizens and the rules of God. So people that are out of Christ, it's very interesting that here we must encourage people to become citizens of heaven. Since you are here, you are already citizens of heaven. You must not need to do all of those things that we do here on earth. When we reach heaven, things change for us and become very different. Which leads us to our next benefit. The seventh benefit of heaven is a heavenly ID card. So you guys know that driver's license. Why do you have a driver's license? Or a passport? What's the purpose of a driver's license or a passport? What are those for? Now you can answer. That's okay. Let's say you go to a different country. You get a stamp on your passport. You must show it to show that you're an American entering another country. Or having an ID, what does it show? It says who you are. So like if a cop pulls you over, they ask you for your ID, they want to make sure that's your card. In heaven, we have a heavenly ID card. If we look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 13, yes, at one time, you were far away from God. But now, in Jesus Christ, you are brought near to him. You are brought near to God through the blood sacrifice of Christ. This is the stamp on your heavenly ID card. The stamp is Jesus' blood given to us on the cross. This is our heavenly ID. This shows that we are followers. We are believers, correct? That we have faith and that we are a part of his church, and that is our ID. So here we know the rules, we know the laws, we follow them in order to obtain our driver's license. And our ID in heaven was paid for by the blood of Christ. our heavenly passport is stamped with the blood of Christ. Now get that our heavenly ID has no expiration date, that this ID is good for eternity, never needing to be renewed. It is good for eternity. That's the benefit. There's no expiration date on your heavenly ID card. Like, you know, like your driver's license might expire like October 24th. You have to go into the DMV, get your picture taken, get a new license. The heavenly ID card is good forever. I don't know, you might get one picture. Huh. I'm not exactly sure what's up with that, but it lasts forever. Which brings us to the eighth benefit. The eighth benefit is a daily refuge of peace. So this is there's a few different options to sign for refuge. We find this in the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verse 14 and 15. Christ is the reason we are now at peace. He made us Jews, and you who are not Jews, one people. We were separated by a wall of hate that stood between us, but Christ broke down the wall by giving his own body. Christ ended the law with its many commands and rules. His purpose was to make the two groups become one in him. By doing this, he would make peace. So in the world, we see a lot of hatred, division, conflicts, different groupings, different races, different colors. In Christ, we are one. This is why we are together in the body of Christ, to serve him as one. See the word peace. Notice that it is written down twice. Do not hate each other. Peace. Forgive each other. Find that peace and offer that peace, and you shall feel free. Break down the walls and see each other. Forgive each other. It's not that hard. Right now, that hatred stands a wall that's thick of hate and emotions. Emotions aren't easy, but at the same time, we still must break that wall and come together. And we can move on with our lives. For this is important. For us to feel like we have purpose. When Jesus reigns, and when he reigns, he reigns supreme, and our lives are gifted to honoring him, and in return we shall get peace and unity. For he will make sure that all of us that come together in love. for he died on the cross. Before Jesus died on the cross, there was that wall, but that wall has been broken down, but we must break the walls that we ourselves build to become one with that greater family. This is why he emphasized the Jewish people versus the not Jewish people, and that wall was broken down so that we must become one people. Before there was a wall that divided, said the Jewish people were the Lord's people. And then Jesus, through his sacrifice, tore down that wall and unified all the people as God's children. This is why we say our Heavenly Father. We will rule together, or be ruled together in heaven, without hatred, without prejudice, without retaliation, without strife. All those shall be gone. And before he died on the cross, there were many rules and laws. Yes, there were many, too many for people to follow. But upon his death, the rules less. We then had the Ten Commandments. I mean, there's a few more that we should follow, and we follow, but we no longer feel like we should blame, we should not be so stubborn. We must create a line, a boundary, a line in the sand. Where Jesus said, he who has no sin cast the first stone, and yet no one was able to, for they all had sin. And he told the woman, do not sin again, and go off and be free. And what did the woman leave with? No more sin. Was she continuing to go along her sinful ways, or was she grateful? Yes, grateful, for she felt his mercy. Jesus is our peace. Jesus was insulted, but he did not fight back. Jesus was mocked. He did not retaliate. Jesus was accused, but he did not defend himself. And when Jesus was crucified, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He showed up in Luke chapter 13, verse 14. He talked to so many people. What did he do? He changed history. He found a way for people to realize, and through him accepting Jesus, there was now a way where before him there was none. If Jesus reigns in your life, you will respond. As Jesus will respond. Forgiveness. Just forgive someone and say, I forgive you. Go in peace. You don't need to have that strife. For with that strife, you have no joy or peace. You must let go of those feelings and live as Jesus wants you to. Let it go. That is a great benefit, a daily refuge of peace. Number 10, the 10th benefit, a new and loving family. This comes from Matthew chapter 18, verse 15. If your brother or sister in God's family does something wrong, go and tell them what they did wrong. Do this when you are alone with them. If they listen to you, then you have helped them to be your brother or sister again. That forgiveness, to feel like your family again, to have that reconnection, to not have that boundary or line, but instead connect. When Jesus became the peace, He abandons all negative things. He let it go so that we might have that relationship and connection to God. For we are all brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ. It does not matter your race or your age. It does not matter what language you know. It doesn't matter your status here on earth. We are all one in the family of Christ. One. There's not two, three, four families, different groups, divisions, but instead, one. For Jesus has already established a place in heaven for his family. And on earth, he gathers his children. And we gather with other believers. We have heavenly blood running through our veins, for we are family. Period. When you come to church, I see you. We are family. This is why we give hugs and how are you and checking in. We are family. We do not reject each other. Instead, we simply walk together in the way of the Lord. The 10th benefit that we receive, this is the last one I will talk about today. The 10th benefit is a new home in heaven. This is found in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20 through 22. You believers are like a building that God owns. That building was built on the foundation that the apostles and the prophets prepared. Christ Jesus himself is the most important stone in that building. That Jesus is the foundation. The whole building is joined together in Christ and he makes it grow and become a holy temple in the Lord. So look at part B where it says, in the Lord. And in Christ, you are being built together with his other people. You are being made into a place where God lives through the Spirit. In Jesus, all are built together. So your temple is your body. Take care of it. Keep it clean. Same as you would our home. Our body is the home that our spirit lives in, so you must take care of its home. In him, we together are built. And this is the place where God lives through the Spirit. It's not a regular home, but rather a holy temple in heaven. And this is our home. And we are the home in which the Spirit of the Lord lives. The tenth benefit is that he gives us a new home. Our life right now versus our new home where we live for eternity. Where we have that connection to the Spirit. Now notice that the tenth benefit is connected to all the ones that came before. So in conclusion, the Bible shows and teaches that God has written your name in the book of life. Do not write or have your name written in pencil, for the pencil can be easily erased. So this is not what's going on. Instead, your name is written on there, not with pencil. So it used to be he would write your name, we don't want it to be your name written in the book of life. You commit a sin and it is erased. You cannot sin over and over. You must repent and change. But if you promise your life to Jesus Christ, he guarantees your acceptance in heaven. And in the book of life, your name shows up. Not written in pencil, but written in the blood of Christ. That is the benefit that we now know. Next week, we will have a guest speaker, Bobby McCoy. I think he's a little bit more exciting and more animated than I am, so I'm hoping that you guys are excited to have him. And it'll be in 2 weeks, we're going to have number 4 to our series, The Blessings of Heaven, where we will discuss the different blessings. So far we've discussed joy, beauty, and benefits, but then we'll be discussing the blessings of heaven. Now, one more reminder before you leave, please join us in the fellowship hall to enjoy some pancake brunch and join us for fellowship. Again, it'll be in the fellowship hall after service today. Before we do close up, I do want to show you a picture. It's cute picture time. This one was found on the internet. So it's going to be kind of a good one. If you like cars, you'll get this. Okay, so why is the dog? Because you have the Jaguar and then the other car, well, has a dog. The next picture is from Shannon, who's not here to get today. So I do hope that this is a can that she care about. But 1 second. Blessed, not stressed. Blessed, not stressed is what this states. The last and third picture I did find out on the internet again. It is a car. So this is like the holder, like you have a holder for your phone, you have a cup holder. Well, this says, I bought a new car. It came with a puppy holder. All right, so now it is time to say the Lord's Prayer. Do we have any volunteers who would like to lead us in the Lord's Prayer? The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Deliver us from evil. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The blessings. May God go before you to guide you. May he go behind you to encourage you. With you to be a friend. Above you to watch over you. And within you to give you peace. Our closing prayer. I hope you enjoy this week. We're supposed to have some wonderful weather, some absolutely beautiful weather. It's going to be nice and warm. So please get out and enjoy the wonderful weather and God's creation. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for showing us all of the different benefits that heaven will give us and what heaven looks like, and the wonderful grace and mercy that you have provided us through Jesus. For with the acceptance of Jesus Christ in our hearts, we know that we will sit beside you in heaven to see your face, to ask questions. And I am excited and am positive for this, for it shall be such full of such beauty and joy, with no death, renewed life, and your heavenly family. Make us who you want us to be. Help us use those gifts, the spiritual gifts that you have given us, to live a meaningful life here on earth. Please answer the prayers, both that were written and put into the box, as well as those that are on the hearts and minds of all who follow you. We continue to pray, and we thank you for the sacrifice that Jesus did on the cross, and through his blood, saving us from our sins and offering us a path to cleanse us of those sins that we have here. For Jesus said, he sacrificed so sins will be no more, to break the chains of temptation. We ask that you help us repent, to help lead us not into temptation, but to change and create, establish the, you know, or to follow the established way that Jesus has set for us to reach you. Touch those hearts of your believers and be with us always. For this we thank you. Keep us safe. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May God bless you all.
Woo!